right, good morning, everybody. Welcome back. It's November 29th, Sunday, November 29th, and things have gotten a little messed up the last couple weeks. We were out of church for 2 weeks physically, and I had an issue with the computer, so I wasn't able to put the lesson up from a couple weeks ago. So for those of you watching online, it's been a couple weeks. For those of us in person, it's been a couple weeks as well. And I trust that you've been able to do home Bible study and personal Bible study with your family, with your parents, and possibly if you have a small group that meets, and you've been able to make sure that you're continuing in the Word, being instant in season and out of season. We know that things are different now, and we have to be aware of that and adapt. Just a couple quick announcements. For Shorewood, we're just kind of going, getting back into it. The big thing is our public meetings are back on, and some of the special events are off. But for those of us who are looking forward, like I was, to being back in person Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, we are back. So those of you watching online, those meetings will be available. We're in the teen room today. For those of you watching online, you see this background again. It's not our normal background. We're in the teen room because Mike Taylor is still quarantining for the amount of time that he had to. I don't think he ever actually tested positive, or he might have, but he didn't really have too many symptoms. But he is quarantining, so he's home. And we got actually a small group here, so most of our group is not here. I think some of them are recovering from Thanksgiving, probably ate too much. But I know some are out of town for Thanksgiving. So it's Thanksgiving holiday. Everybody hopefully enjoyed their 4 days, and we're able to be thankful. Let's start off with a couple songs. Psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Those are important. It's good to have God's word in your heart and in your memory, and songs are a great way to put it there. So, all right. We got a trio here, so we'll see how it goes. Anybody got a song that they want to sing? 53? 53. At the Cross. That's a good one. All right, you guys want to stand up? All right. Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I have done, he groaned upon the tree? Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Well might the sun in darkness hide, and shut his glories in, when Christ the mighty Maker died for man the creature's sin. At the cross where I saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away, 'tis all that I can do. faith I receive my sight, and now I am happy all the day. All right. Very good. At the cross. Another one? Number what? Nine?
Oh, no, I was just saying 94.
94. He took my sins away, and that's a good one. Follow up at the cross. All right, 94 is he took my sins away. I came to Jesus weary, worn, and sad. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. And now his love has made my heart so glad. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. And keeps me singing every day. I'm so glad he took my sins away. He took my sins away. The load of sin was more than I could bear. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. And now on him I roll my every care. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. And keeps me singing every day. I'm so glad he took my sins away. He took my sins away. No condemnation have I in my heart. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. His perfect peace he did to me impart. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. And keeps me singing every day. I'm so glad he took my sins away. He took my sins away. If you will come to Jesus Christ today, he'll take your sins away, he'll take your sins away, and keep you happy in his love each day. He'll take your sins away. He took my sins away, he took my sins away, and keeps me singing every day. I'm so glad he took my sins away. He took my sins away. All right. I think that's good. Those were two. We don't sing that often. Hopefully you watching online are familiar with these songs. If not, you can probably Google them or look them up on your computer or your phone. And you can sing along. I know it's tough with me leading. But that's the best we got. So, all right, how does the Lord Jesus Christ take our sins away? Kind of reminds me of the verse in the book of Colossians. When you think about that, the most important thing for a person is having their sins removed. Colossians chapter 2, if you look verse 13, Colossians 2:13, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. That's a wonderful truth. When you think about that, the end of verse 13, having forgiven you all trespasses, there's great comfort in knowing that all our sins, all of our trespasses, all of our mistakes have been forgiven by the Lord Jesus Christ. And he did that at the cross. You can see that. It was everything that was contrary to us, everything that was against us, everything that proved that we were worthy of death, not only physical death, for the wages of sin is death, but that second death, that spiritual death. Revelation chapter 21 talks about the second death. Finishes up with a list of sinful activities, and it says, "And all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone." That's just a horrible end to a life filled with sin, to a life filled with mistakes, a life filled with destruction, a life filled with hate, a life filled with anger and wrath. And that's what the flesh is full of. And there's a place for the flesh. Fortunately, again, when we think about this verse here in Colossians 3, the Lord Jesus Christ nailed it to the cross. If you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, another encouraging verse, verse 21, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, "For he," talking about God the Father, "hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." That great exchange, the Lord Jesus Christ willingly, obediently, Philippians says he was obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. He was obedient unto his Father and his Father's word, and he went to the cross. He took our sins. He became sin for us. I was just saying that hymn at the cross, and he said, "Such a worm as I." We think about Psalm 22. We think about the Lord Jesus Christ saying, "I am a worm." Can you imagine the second person of the Godhead saying, "I am a worm"? Did he deserve to be that? No. Should he have been that? No. Okay? Lord Jesus Christ is not to be a worm, and yet he became that. He became that for us. He became that for me, and became that for you. We think about the Lord Jesus Christ in Psalm 22, verse 6, "But I am a worm and no man." Okay? That was the result of him accepting our punishment, accepting our sentence of eternal death. And yet he willingly went there because he loved us. And when we think about love, and I just want to take a few verses today and look over, when we think about Thanksgiving holiday, Thanksgiving is a day that should ring very true for us as believers. Every day should be a very thankful day when we think about who we are in Christ, when we think about who we were in ourselves, and the wonderful truth that's been revealed to us in God's Word. God left his Word, and for us in the United States of America, we have access to that Word freely. We can meet here at a place like Shorewood and Rolling Meadows freely. We can meet here without persecution. We can meet here without threat of pain, without threat of hurt, without threat of death. And we have God's Word laying all over the place. There's Bibles everywhere, and we can read it. Most people, and many people in many countries today, don't have that privilege to do it as easily as we have it here in the United States. And yet Satan is always trying to stop what God is doing. And he's trying to stop the body of Christ. And he's trying to stop God's Word from being spoken. He does that on a personal level with each of us, tries to intimidate us through fear, tries to get us to clam up, to shut our mouths, to not speak the truth. Okay? He does it to the body of Christ. He tries to split and divide the body of Christ. He's a great divider. He does that through broken relationships. He does that through pride. Okay? He does it through sin. He uses our flesh against us. Our flesh is there to serve itself. And yet God's Word gives us the understanding that as members of the body of Christ, we are working in a ministry together. The church is the pillar and ground of the truth, and we have a part of that. We have to be thankful for that. When we think about Thanksgiving, I just want to look at a couple verses. If you look at Colossians chapter 3, we've been spending in the junior high class before all this breakup the last 2 weeks. We've been spending some time looking at the three phases of salvation. Initial salvation, daily salvation, and then our final salvation. Obviously, those are three different types of salvation. Initial salvation is our justification. What does it mean to be justified? To To be declared righteous. Very good. Okay, we need to be declared righteous to be saved. We can't be unrighteous and be saved. Okay, we need to be justified. All right, that comes from placing our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ's blood, and his blood alone is the only payment for our sins. That's how we are justified today. God the Father looks down and he sees us. He declares us righteous in his Son when we put our faith in Christ's blood alone. Our daily salvation is our sanctification. What is our sanctification? We've been created for a new purpose. All right, we've been set apart. We've been set apart for a new purpose. All right, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Who knows it by heart? We all do. For the most part, we can be thankful for that. I'm thankful that my parents brought me to a church. Hey, good morning, sir. Come on in. Got plenty of seats. Good to see you. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, if you know it by heart, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Okay? And then it goes on in verse 10 to say, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. That's our daily walk. Okay, that's our sanctification. That's us looking different when we are on walking around on this earth. The normal human, the natural man, the natural flesh of people is going to act in a selfish way. It's going to act in a sinful way. We as believers, we show something different. Think about the fruits of the Spirit. Think about our attitudes, and our attitudes and our inner man leads to outward actions. Okay, and those outward actions should look different to the world around us, because the world around us is interested only in profit for themselves. All right, believers, we can be interested in profit that comes out of God's Word. Remember, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. Okay, it's important to remember that there's profit in God's Word. Most people are looking for profit in their bank account, profit in their wallet, profit in their money, so that they can have money to do things that they want to do. Okay, there's great profit in God's Word. And then our final salvation, that's the day that the body of Christ is gathered together. We have that final gathering together. We call it the rapture. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and other places, we see that we're going to get our new body, and the body of Christ is going to be connected together with the Lord Jesus Christ for the first time, and it will be a most amazing, wonderful reunion. It says it happens in the twinkling of an eye. It's going to be very quick, and those that are saved are going to be connected forever. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul says in verse 51, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. All right, that changing is an encouraging thing. If you look at the book of Philippians, we see more specifics about our change in Philippians chapter 3. Verse 20, Paul says, for our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, Philippians 3:21, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. You excited to get a new body? You excited to get a new body that can function in the heavenly places, that never dies? All right, it can't be destroyed, it can't be pained, it can't get sick. Okay? When we look around and we see people that are in trouble, we see people that are hurting, people that don't have their health, one day each and every one of us will succumb to that. It's called disease. It's called death. To point it on the man wants to die, but after that, the judgment. When we think about Thanksgiving, I want to look at just a couple verses. If you turn to Colossians chapter 3, and again in Colossians chapter 3 in the junior high class, we've gone over these first verses in Colossians chapter 3. If you need a Bible, Sarah, there's one there on the table if you need it. You're welcome to get it. Colossians chapter 3, the first four verses kind of sum up those those issues of the three pieces of salvation. Colossians chapter 3, verse 1, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Who's risen with Christ? Believers? Unbelievers? You know, if you go back, here we are in Colossians 3. If you go back to Colossians 2, we were just in that passage. Colossians chapter 2, you look at verse 12, buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead. All right, that's that guarantee that we have eternal life. We've got the sealed with the Holy Spirit. We have access to God the Father through the Lord Jesus Christ, and we have that new life. We have that, we're now that new creature. All right, Colossians chapter 3, verse 2, set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. And then verse 4, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Okay, so we're looking for the Lord Jesus Christ. Are we afraid of his return? As believers, no. We're looking forward to his return. We can't wait for his return. What do we know about his return? What's his return? The Lord Jesus Christ, the next time he returns, what's that going to mean? When you think of time, when you think of life on the timeline, this timeline that the Bible lays out. The Lord Jesus Christ returns at the rapture, and what comes to an end? Dispensation, the grace of God, comes to an end. All right, you go from grace back to law. You go back to prophecy. You go from mystery to prophecy. Remember, you ever seen a parenthesis? You know, you read even Bible verses and there's a parenthesis in there. That's what the dispensation of grace is like for us. All right, the Bible is prophecy. The Bible is law. In the Old Testament, in time past, Paul lays out three time periods: time past, but now, ages to come. Okay. The but now is this mystery that's been revealed. It was revealed to Paul, only Paul, by the Lord Jesus Christ personally. And then he took that information and he was faithful to disseminate it, to get it out, to pass it around, to get God's word into copies, to preserve God's word through copies, to pass it around to different groups. Okay? Who were some of the groups he passed it to? We have names of the books, right? All right, he wrote letters. He wrote epistles. All right, those are the people he sent it to. But did he just send it to them? No, his intention was that those letters would be copied. That's how God's word has been preserved and passed around throughout the generations. God's word is intended to be in a written form so we can read it. What's Satan trying to do to that written form? Men were burned at the stake. Women were burned at the stake. Okay? People have been hurt. People have been persecuted. People have been tortured. People have been killed to try to keep them from hanging on to this word, to try to keep them from passing this word around, to try to shut them up. Okay? We see right now in our culture, people are trying to get other people to be quiet. How do they do that? We see it in politics. We see it in spiritual things. We see it in social issues. If you don't agree with what the masses agree with, what do they try to do? We call it cancel culture. We call it they're trying to quiet you. Do they do it nicely? Do they say, hey, we really would like you to stop talking about that? No. They threaten. They threaten. They try to invoke fear. They try to get you to be afraid. We're going to hurt you physically. We're going to hurt you financially. How do they hurt you physically? You know, fists, hands, weapons, okay? You know, they want to lay hands on you. The Apostle Paul, how many times was he beaten? How many times was he hurt physically? He was whipped. He was stoned. Okay? Why did all that happen to Paul? He was imprisoned, falsely accused. He was treated as an evildoer. Was he going around doing evil? No. He was going around preaching the word. He was going around sharing the gospel, sharing the mystery. Satan doesn't want that. Satan doesn't want that shared. Satan wants that quiet. Okay? He wants to keep that hid. Satan wants the truth hid. All right? That's important to remember. Satan does not want the truth revealed. So don't be surprised when you start speaking the truth that somebody's going to try to shut you up. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. Okay? In whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. If you go up to verse 1 and 2 of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, Paul talks about the ministry, he talks about feigning not. He says in verse 2, we've renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, committing ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. Satan perverts God's word. That's what religion is all about. Think about Cain. Think about what Satan convinced Cain to do. Disobey God. He did it to his mom, Eve. What did he say? Disobey God's word. Don't listen to God's word. Don't trust God's word. He convinced Eve that God's word, God doesn't have the best intentions for you. You need to look out for number one. We call that selfishness. We call that, I'm gonna take care of me. Satan told Eve, take care of you. You got to take care of you. There's things that God's hidden from you. With Cain, you got to do it your way. You make God accept your way. You become your own God. Okay? We think about down through the ages, all of mankind that has followed after Satan, which is easy to do for our flesh because our flesh is totally consumed with me, me, me. All right? It's important to remember when we get saved, we understand it's not about me. About my Savior. It's about the Lord Jesus Christ, and I want others to know. I want to share that truth with others, and I'm not going to be afraid of people that are going to try to stop me from sharing that truth. Sometimes it's going to be easy. Sometimes it's not going to be easy. Sometimes it's going to be safe. Sometimes it's not going to be safe. Okay? We've seen that in our country just this last year with political things. Spiritual things are going to be worse because the real battle out there is a battle of light and a battle of dark. The Lord Jesus Christ, God the Father, God the Holy Spirit, are light. Satan, his angels, dark. And that battle has been raging since Satan decided that he was going to disobey God's word. And he decided he was going to make up his own program. Okay? We have truth. We have information that can be used to get people saved. And that's the most important thing when we think about what we're doing out there. When we think about being thankful. Here, Paul says down in Colossians, if you go back to Colossians chapter 3, Paul says, I'm having a hard time with my eyeballs here. I think I'm going to need to get my reading glasses back out again. Okay. Look at verse 15, Colossians chapter 3, verse 15. If you start in verse 10, talking after verse 5 through 9, are talking about those works of the flesh that were to put to death, mortify. See the first word in verse 5, Colossians 3, 5. Put these things down. Put them to death in your life. Verse 10. So you put off the old man, verse 5 through 9, verse 10, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. You want to see purity of care for one another, that's found in the body of Christ. Verse 11, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all. We have a wonderful acceptance of all of us, regardless of our social standing, our racial standing, our financial standing, our standing in popular culture. Regardless of all that, in Christ we have an even footing. We have an even setting. Verse 12, Paul tells us to put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering. Verse 13, forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. That should remind you of Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32. Two verses that will transform your life as a believer, as a human being walking around on this earth. Understanding that your failures are completely forgiven in Christ at the cross. And you can forgive others, because you're going to need to do it. All right, we're going to have to forgive one another. We're going to have to forbear one another. There's going to be quarrels. There's going to be troubles. There's going to be wrongs. Forgiveness, as we've learned, our forgiveness at the cross, how the Father forgives us of all trespasses. He nailed it to the cross when the Lord Jesus Christ was nailed in and paid for all our sins. We can do that. We can forgive one another. You know, that's a powerful, powerful thing in your life here on this earth. Verse 14, and above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. Verse 15, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. Okay? If you look down verse 17, verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord, and whatsoever ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. That heart of thanks, as we just came through the Thanksgiving holiday. Most of us are thankful for the four-day weekend, the guaranteed time off. We get real excited about it. I do. But as a believer, we think about what we really have to be thankful for, regardless of our situation. Regardless of our circumstance, we have this amazing, amazing grace that's been shown to us at the cross. And then we have God's Word, and we can be thankful. Paul reminds us, be thankful, giving thanks to God the Father by him, whatsoever you do in word or deed. That's a tall order. That's called how you live your life. Are you going to be thankful? Or are you going to be like Romans chapter 1? Look at Romans chapter 1. Here's the opposite. When we think about the Gentiles in time past, the God of creation is there. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit are there. They've provided. When we think about being thankful for our life, being thankful for how we live and what's available to us. All right? Hold on to Romans chapter 1. You guys know the verse. And look at Acts. Let's go to Acts chapter 14. Get Acts chapter 14. And Paul, as he stands up for the Lord and teaches and preaches in verse 15. Remember that they want to worship Paul. They want to talk to him as because of the miracles that he's done as someone special. Acts 14, verse 15, and here's Paul, and he says in verse 13, they're going to do sacrifice. All right, they're going to do sacrifice unto Paul and Barnabas. They're calling them these Greek gods in verse 12. Barnabas, Jupiter, Paul, Mercurius. So in verse 14, Paul, it says, which when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard of it, they rent their clothes and ran in among the people, crying and saying, sirs, why do ye these things? We also are men of like passions with you, and preach unto you that ye should turn from these vanities What are the vanities? Worshipping other gods, worshipping idols, worshipping perceived power. Turn from all that, and turn, that you should turn from these vanities unto the living God, which made heaven and earth and the sea and all things that are therein. Paul begins to reveal the God of creation, the God of the Bible, to them. What does he say in verse 16? Who in time past suffered all nations to walk in their own ways. He said, okay, go ahead and do it. Do it your way. Verse 17, nevertheless, he left not himself without witness, in that he did good and gave us rain from heaven and fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with what? Food and gladness. What do you normally think when you look outside and it's raining? Yeah, you go, ah, it's raining. Why don't we like that? It's dark, it's thundering, you get wet. Ah, guy, you can't go outside and play. If I run to the car, my hairdo gets messed up, and my clothes get messed up, and I'm going to get wet. Now I stepped in a puddle, and now my foot is soaked. So a lot of times we think of rain as this bad thing. What's the amazing thing of rain? Food, water, fruitful seasons, fruit, filling our hearts with food and gladness. Over the Thanksgiving holiday, what was your favorite meal? What was your favorite food? You know, you think about it, you say, I really like that. Ooh, that tasted so good. You ever smile when you're eating? You ever take a food that really tastes good, a drink that really tastes good, and maybe you drink something you like? Milkshake, can of pop, ice cream, steak, rice, vegetables. Maybe you love asparagus, broccoli. Maybe you love a peach. Whatever that food is that you love, who does it come from? It comes from the God of creation. It comes from creation. It comes from the rain. It comes from God's creation working, even in a cursed environment. The Lord curses the environment for man's sake, and yet we still have this amazing, wonderful, enjoyable fruit. Food, fullness. Okay? That's what Paul reveals. Romans chapter 1. Here's the Gentiles. Verse 21. Verse 20 says, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Paul says, human beings look around and they know the God of creation created everything. They know the Godhead exists. They understand the power. When you look up and you see the sun, you see the moon, you see the clouds, you see the power of rain, the power of sun, the power of cold, the power of snow. There's no excuse. Verse 20 concludes, so that they are without excuse. Verse 21, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. That attitude of, I'm not going to be thankful to my Creator. I'm not going to be thankful to the God of the Bible. I'm going to dismiss him. I'm going to push him out of my life. And when you push out the light, you get darkness. And their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. Okay? That's that unthankful heart. That's who Satan is. Unthankful for what he had. Unthankful for the position. Unthankful for the creation that he was created. The wisdom he was given. the abilities he was given, the light bearer, the songs, the singing, the music, unthankful. And he passes that unthankfulness along to us humans. We have an opportunity to be thankful. We have an opportunity to give thanks. All right, back to Colossians chapter 3. In Colossians chapter 3, Paul, here in two verses, verse 17, and whatsoever you do, Colossians 3:17, whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. We have so much to be thankful for. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We mentioned that gathering together. We term it the rapture, that gathering together in the body of Christ, that changing that's going to happen, that immediate change that's going to happen to all believers. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 54, so when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, you think about winning. How many people like to win? You know, people buy lotto tickets and people go to the casino, they're trying to win money. People get involved with sports, they practice, they work hard, they're trying to win first. They're trying to win the prize, they're trying to win the trophy, trying to win the medal. We have classes here, you learn verses, you get a trophy, you do points, you get a trophy. Humans are, we in our flesh, we love to win. We want to be first. And yet here's a victory that has nothing to do with us. Verse 57, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 58, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. We are a part of an ultimate victory program. Can the victory be denied? No. That's what Romans chapter 8 talks about when it says nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. Nothing. Satan, his angels, other creatures, the world, pain, suffering, the government, neighbors, enemies, friends, nothing can separate us. So Paul says, because of that victory, be steadfast. Be unmovable. Stand fast. Okay? When we think about the believer's warfare in Ephesians 6, Pastor Jordan's been talking about that for months now. Stand. Okay? We're to stand. What do we stand for? Yeah, stand for what we believe in. Stand for the truth in God's Word. The mystery, God's Word rightly divided. God's Word in the King James Bible. Where is God's Word located? What does God's Word say? How do we study it? We study it according to 2 Timothy 2:15. We believe God's Word based on 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. Stand for what you believe in. Stand for what's right. Satan wants you to sit down and go hide under a table, hide behind a bush, hide in your closet, hide in your bedroom. Paul says, be steadfast, be unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. That comes from a heart of thankfulness. We know that the world is not thankful. We as believers have so much to be thankful for. As Gentiles, understanding that God's word was directed at God's people, the nation Israel, not us. Ephesians chapter 2 says we were without hope. We had no hope. We were aliens. If anyone should be thankful, it's a Gentile and the dispensation of grace. We have opportunity to be a part, to have a relationship with, to be loved by the God of the Bible. When we think about being loved, and I was thinking about this, when David and Bathsheba had the first baby dies, the next baby is Solomon. And it says the Lord loved him. And all of us are looking for love. We're looking for that acceptance and that feeling of knowing that somebody cares for you, no matter what screw-ups you do and no matter what mistakes you make. We find that love in God the Father, in the Lord Jesus Christ, in the Holy Spirit. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 6, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved. We're accepted, we're loved, we're cared for by the God, by the Godhead. And that's a wonderful place to be, and it's a wonderful place to find comfort, to find encouragement, to find strength, knowing that we are loved. Look at one last verse and we'll quit. Romans chapter 8. Paul tells us that we can use this wonderful word. Romans 8:14, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. All right, we see the Lord Jesus Christ call his Father. He uses that term, Abba, Father. And here we are able to use that term. What a wonderful truth. What a wonderful thing to encourage us and to give us pause when we realize who we are in Christ, the security we have, the lack of fear of death, the power of death, the penalty of death, eternal death. We don't have to fear that because of the Lord Jesus Christ. All right? Again, just when we think about all we have, when we think about the difference it can make, when we just have a heart of thankfulness, because our flesh is never satisfied, and yet we are complete in Christ. That means everything can satisfy it. The Godhead has a plan, the dispensation of grace. It's that humans like you and me who are messed up, screwed up, not perfect, can have part in God's eternal plan, the Godhead's eternal plan. And we get that part just by putting our faith in Christ's blood. What a wonderful truth that is. Okay. Let's have a word of prayer. We'll be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the truth, thankful for your word, what it teaches us, thankful that we can read it. Thankful that we live in a country where we've been educated, we can read, we have your word, it's in our language, we have a King James Bible, it's true, we can test it, we can read it for ourselves. I pray that each of us would do that, that we grow in your word and that we be satisfied with your word, we'd be thankful, and that it would show in our lives as we go out in this sin-cursed world that we shine as lights. We're thankful for the Lord Jesus Christ, his complete obedience to you. Amen. All right, good to be back. We'll see you next week.